Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, we bless you for who you are. We thank you for sparing our lives to be found in your presence today. Lord, in your kindness, we need you. Give us an open heaven today. Touch everyone's life today. Speak to us, Lord Jesus. Speak to our situation. We also pray for whom you have set apart today, our dear Reverend, Mackays, that you have sent to us to bring your word. In your kindness, use him as your oracle. All for your name to be magnified. In the name of God the Father, Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated for our reading.
A reading from the Word of God, from Matthew 4, verses 1 to 11. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you. And on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to rest, to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
What a blessing to have our dear brother, Reverend Mark Hayes, all the way from St. Mary Takarigua. Is that from Australia or New Zealand? How was your flight?
It was good.
Thank you. Let us appreciate our dear brother. Thank you so much for having time to come. Although we have a hymn before.
Yes.
Okay. Shall we all stand as we prepare our hearts to hear from the Lord? And we prefer that you use the pulpit here, or you prefer to stand there so that you'll be more closer to the people.
Which one? There's better?
It's going to help you with the lecture.
No problem.
Okay, tell the organist. Mr. Mike, he has a hymn that would like you to sing for him.
Blessed lunch, my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. So we begin as we honestly listen to the words of this hymn. It's one of my favorite hymns, and I think in reflecting on resisting temptation, this is an applicable hymn to ask for us to take that introspective view of ourselves as we ask God to allow us and ask God to search us. So hymn number 850, "Search Me, O God."
Search me, O God.
brothers and sisters in Christ. Mm. I come to you in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated. I want to ask one question, though. I see majority of the people on this side. And it has so much room on this side. It have a reason why so much people down to the back on this side. It have plenty of room up here. Anybody want to come closer? Or do you all have any AC? All right. I just ask you, because I just wanted to know why, if you all were afraid of me, and you all didn't want to come closer, so I just making sure. It is my pleasure to be here with you. I have been a visitor at this church for many times. I have been involved in many youth activities here, and it is a pleasure to be here this afternoon to offer praise and thanks and a reflection of God's will. I bring you greetings from the parish of St. Mary in Tacarigua, from Father Maxwell and the rest of clergy there. So thank you, Father Ayo. Resisting temptation. It is a very interesting topic, especially during the period of Lent. We are tempted to do so much things. Sometimes during this period, it feels as though everything goes wrong. You all ever have that feeling? When you're trying to do something good, you feel like everything going wrong around that period. Anybody else have that feeling sometimes? No? Okay, now I like an interactive congregation, right? So you all can feel free to talk. We are here to chat, all right? The topic today of resisting temptation, especially in relation to the scripture reading, it outlines to us that Jesus was allowed to feel that earthly aspect, that connection to us, that aspect of temptation. But the first thing I want us to remember is that temptation is not sin, at least not as yet. So we'll start with that aspect. Temptation is that aspect, forgive me, my notes fell. Is it possible to get a mic stand?
Yes. Standing by. Okay, should I give you the pin one?
I just want something.
Let me give you this one.
Are you all hearing me? You all hearing me clearly? Wonderful. So I think it should be easier for me now to use both hands, especially seeing as I have to rearrange these papers here in my hand. So we have to remember, in the scripture today, Jesus faced three temptations. The three temptations represents different aspects, different categories of temptation. The first temptation was that of the body, the second of the mind, and the third of the heart. So the three temptations, they are not just random, but Satan, he knew exactly what he was doing. When Jesus, for example, was tempted, and he was tempted with bread, the physical temptation of the body, Satan, that will be found in Matthew 4, verses 3 to 4, he knew that Satan's offer, because he knew that God will provide for us the daily bread. When he provides that daily bread for us, that shows us that Jesus exercises faith over the bodily hunger and lust. So when the devil came to Jesus, and he has been fasting for 40 days, imagine Jesus at this point in time when Satan came to him at his lowest. He came to him when he knew what his craving would have been in that aspect of his humanity. So when he knew, he came to him and he knew, and he said, yeah, boy, I could probably get you to Jesus. I could probably get him now because 40 days, he's famished, he's hungry. It's easy to get through to him because he was appealing to the flesh, the mortal side, the human side of Jesus. When he appealed to the side and he asked him, turn the stone into bread. Satan knew the capacity that Jesus had. Because later on, when Jesus chose to stay hungry at this point in time, we could remember, and we cannot doubt in ourselves that Jesus could have done it. Because we saw with the feeding of the 4,000 and the feeding of the 5,000 that Jesus was being able to feed the masses through the power of God. So it's not that he could not turn the bread, the stone into bread, but it is that he understood that one does not live by bread alone, but by the word that comes from the mouth of God. So we understand that. And in our own lives, we are called to remember that. That sometimes we who are in a world that seeks immediate and instant gratification for everything tend to forget that sometimes we have to hold on a little bit. We have to hold on and say to ourselves, hey, here's what God is telling us. Wait a little bit. Wait a little while. Because you are not ready for it as yet. This blessing is, you are not ready. Hold on. Or do not test God. So that comes into the second temptation. The second temptation represents humility over pride and spectacle. The temptation here really mirrors the relationship between our Christian faith and our doubt. At this point in time, Satan brings Jesus to the tallest building. And many of us like to do this, and we find ourselves guilty of these things as Christians. I will do it. God will be at my side. I could drive a little bit faster. God will protect me. And we tempt God. We put all these things in our lives, and we face temptation daily. And we say, God will understand. Does that phrase sound familiar to anybody? God will understand, that is why I will do it. Or God will forgive me, that is why I will do it. We have to remember that we are trusting in God. But not because we trust in God, we are going to put ourselves in a situation where we are going to end up either harming ourselves or are we here to make God a spectacle. Is God a part of a circus? Is God here on display for our personal amusement and showing people that he is there and challenges? Is that the purpose? This sin or this temptation, it represents or symbolizes humility over the public feats of faith. Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand. If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. And Jesus reminded him, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Now the third temptation, it reminds us of our loyalty to God. Satan, he came at that point in time and he wanted to test his pride. He said, here's what's going on. You see all these things, this kingdom. I will give it to you if you bow down.
And if you bow down and worship me, I will give it to you. But Jesus knows that the only person who deserves our worship is God. The only person that deserves us to bow before and offer thanks, praise, and worship is God Almighty. Yet in our own lives, daily we face these temptations, especially the third one, where persons offer us that opportunity of stardom, persons offer us that opportunity to be of power, of position, where we are offered, and what are we willing to sacrifice in return for this? What are we willing to give of ourselves, our lives, and our souls to receive this worldly gratification? When the devil takes him, Jesus reminds us that we will worship the Lord our God and serve him only. Serve him only. It does not mean we are not going to be obedient and listen to our bosses and do what we are supposed to do. Render unto Caesar what is Caesar and unto God what is God's. So we can't go here and tell our boss, I'm not listening to you because I only listen to God. No. Don't take it out of context. We have a job, we have responsibilities, and we do them to the best of our ability. But when it comes to the word of God, we apply it to every aspect of our lives. So while we're in the same job, we don't go and say, here's what, try and steal the boss clients and you can make a little something for yourself on the side. Or you don't go and you steal any stationery because your children have CXC and all these things coming up. We resist all these temptations, but we focus on the word of God. And we are empowered by the word of God. Because remember, temptation, my dear friends, is a desire to do something. You're tempted to do all kinds of things. Because the devil knows where we are weak and where we are strong. And he knows in a group where to attack with the weakest link as well. So temptation is the desire to do something, whereas sin is the act of doing something unfaithful or condemnable. Or, I will say it differently, and if we turn to page 393 in our books of common prayer, in our catechism, sin is our refusal, this is page 393, sin is our refusal or failure to do God's will, either by disobedience or by omission. In these ways, we distort our relationship with God, with ourselves, and with other people, and with all creation. I will repeat. Sin is our refusal or failure to do God's will, either by disobedience or by omission. And I will stop there. So some people may say, well, I didn't do anything wrong. But did we stand up and do what is right? Did we stand up and obey what it is that God was telling us to do? Or did we, in our fear, allow ourselves to cower and not perform the acts that we are supposed to do or that God calls us to do? And it also affects and distorts our relationship with God, with oneself, and with other people and all creation. And why I specify that temptation and sin are not the same, because we don't want to go out here thinking that Jesus sinned, because Jesus was he without sin, and he was perfect. And he only took our sins upon himself when he went upon the cross. So we have to identify that you are tempted to do something, but the minute we make the decision to do something that is wrong, whether by our actions or omission,
that is when we enter into the realm of sin. So I want us to understand that part. Are you all still with me?
Yes.
Nice. I just want to make sure. I don't like people sleeping, so I'll try to keep it. So how do we resist temptation? We have notepads and pens and pencils out in here today? All right, so we're just taking mental notes. So we're going with that. The first aspect of one of the recommendations is to pray. Pray. Jesus taught us how to pray in Matthew chapter 6. He, in that prayer, he said, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." So that when we know we are going and we ask him, we know we are weak. We seek the help of God. We apply to God for that help so that we will know, hey, here's what I have done. I made a mistake. I know I'm weak. God, give me that strength. Help me to overcome. It's not that God taking you and putting you into temptation, but we are asking God at this point in time to give us the strength, because in our mortal flesh, we are weak. So we want God to give us that strength, that opportunity, so that we now can be strong enough to be able to overcome temptation. The second point is to know yourself. We have to understand, just as much as God knows us, the devil knows you too. So don't let us feel that because Father Ayo and myself, we wear these nice clothes, we don't face temptations too. Because God knows each and every one of us sitting here today, or standing in my case, we have our individual weaknesses. And it is when we spend time in prayer and silent reflection, because I know we like the praise and worship style. I know we love that. I like it too. But you see them moments when we at home and we lock ourselves away and we open our prayer books and open our Bibles and we in silence and we hear God talking to us. You see those moments that many of us are afraid of? The moment when we're so fearful of our own thoughts, of our, what God will say to us, that is the moments we need to pay most attention to. Because at those points in time, God will be speaking to us, guiding us, leading us, so that we will know what we are weak in, what we are strong in. And then further on, in knowing ourselves, we will know how to improve on ourselves and where we need the most work. We are also asked to learn to recognize temptation. Learn to recognize it, because it comes so easy. Now, I don't know about all of you, but growing up, I could tell you all, I yield to the temptation of tea. You see powdered milk? Growing up? Now this was my thing growing up. My parents, whenever they tell me, "Ma, go and sweet me some tea for the family," okay, I count in. Five of us, 2 spoons of milk for each cup, and 2 spoons of meat or milk for me to eat, and pray my mother to find out. And these were the things that as children it's easy and it's simple. And we recognize and we laugh because you see it easy for us to understand. Bring up, yeah, you know, you try. It might be with the milk, it might be the Milo, some might be the candy, some might be teething a little piece of the cake so you cut it thin so the parents ain't gonna notice. And all these different things, right? So growing up, we'd have had that. We ought to know how to recognize where, when we recognize what our weaknesses are, we'll also learn what our temptations are. And then we'll learn how to ask God to give us the strength to overcome these temptations.
You see, once we know certain situations will bring us into temptations, we will know to keep ourselves out of those situations. So if we know when we go to the party, we can't conduct ourselves decently, don't go. If you know you can't drink, don't touch it. Don't put yourself there. And we have to know yourself. I cannot know you for you. God knows you, and he will speak to you. And in spending time with God, you will also get to know yourself better. Know your scripture. Know your scripture. I am not saying you will know every single thing off the bat. But just like we learned our ABCs and how to count from 1 to 100, piece by piece, one step at a time, one Bible verse at a time, we will study it. And we're not reading it just because we want to read a chapter a day. No, read it. Let God speak to you about it. Study, personal Bible study, so that we will know how to let that scripture speak to us. Afraid to say this next one because it's something I don't do often. Rest. We are most susceptible to temptation when we are exhausted. When we are tired, we are weakened, and so more vulnerable to deceptions of the devil. Rest is important for our spirituality, and we must be extra vigilant when we are tired. So we are asking God to give us the strength to resist temptation, so we need to rest. I feel like I'm talking to myself with this one, but yeah, it is what it is. And then remember, this is the firefighter in me, always a means of escape. Whenever if you know that something will tempt you, and for some reason the temptation is growing strong, know your means of escape. Know what it is. Use everything else that you would have had. What you know about yourself, your strengths, your scripture, your friends, God's love, all of these things, so that you will know how to get out of that situation that you would have found yourself in. Friends in Christ, we cannot allow ourselves to get so deep that we cannot fall back. So we cannot allow ourselves to get so much involved that we do not allow ourselves to grow. We will overcome. But we cannot overcome if we do everything or feel that we are doing it on ourselves. Because then we do not have the strength on our own. So we need to seek God. Seek his grace. Seek his mercy. Seek his strength. Seek his understanding. So that when the temptation comes, we do not fall victim. So are we doing what is right? Are we doing what is true? Are we doing what God wants us to do? Or are we just saying to ourselves, we are going through the motions, and I am a Christian, and God will forgive me anyway. Yes, we serve a merciful God, but we also cannot fall into the temptation of doing whatever it may be, and thinking that just because I said God will forgive me, it will be all well. Do not put ourselves, and I say in ourselves because I'm speaking to me as well, into harm's way. We live in a world that is already full of darkness, and a world that is not where many of us grew up. So let us continue to be lights of the world. Let us continue to polish our lamps, and let God continue to be that divining light. as we grow stronger and stronger in our faith. And that God will give us the strength. But we have to remember this one last thing. It is not a sprint. We are running a marathon. So pace yourselves. Because the enemy will come back. And as quickly as you run a little bit, they will come back. And you run a little bit, they will come back. You don't win a marathon by trying to put all your energy in one case. You reserve your energy. You pace yourself. You drink your water and the water stops. And you let Jesus take the lead. Have faith, my friends. And let God continue to inspire you. Do not let this Lenten period pass without we having a true examination of ourselves. And let us truly grow in the kingdom of God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.